Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann. 2011 will go down as one of the most momentous years in the oil market, not just for high prices, also for great geopolitical developments and some real longer-term structural shifts playing out before our eyes. Joining me today to discuss these, hopefully in great depth and provide some insight, are Joel Hanley, Associate Director in charge of our crude oil coverage in EMEA, and Simon Thorne, Editorial Director for European Oil. Joel, I'd like to get straight in with you, if I could. Let's go straight in on crude prices. How high have they been this year and why?
Well, we haven't seen the same highs that we saw in 2008. We haven't seen those $147 a barrel levels that we saw back then. But by the same token, we haven't seen the $35 a barrel level either. So I think this year is very likely, and unless we see some deeply unpredictable things happen towards the end of the year, we're likely to see Dated Brent, the main global benchmark, above $100 a barrel for the year as an average. At the moment, it's standing around $110 a barrel on average for the year. And that's remarkable, but we haven't seen high prices everywhere. The US, for example, has seen a wide divergence from the North Sea light sweet crude, where WTI, the main US benchmark, has seen much lower prices. And that's mostly because of the storage being full at that landlocked delivery point of Cushing, Oklahoma. And that is now easing somewhat, I suppose you could say, because while we've seen a Dated Brent versus WTI spread of up to $29 a barrel almost at times, and these are two grades that, let's remember, on a refining basis should be much closer in value than they are, we're now seeing the ConocoPhillips stake in the Seaway pipeline being sold, and that means that oil can be drawn out of that region at last. And next year we're predicting 150,000 to maybe as much as 400,000 barrels a day being taken away from that area. And that of course relieves the pressure and will naturally lead to a more normal normal spread between Brent and WTI. And this in February was the main talk of the town, I have to say, and we had International Petroleum Week here in London, and all the traders and the refining community descended upon town, and WTI was the big story. But then very soon, of course, in February, Libya, Egypt, Tunisia, countries like this began the Arab Spring, and that of course led to a much, some might say, a bigger story for the year, which has been the shut-ins that we saw in Libya, with a lot of light sweet crude taken out of the market, particularly in the Mediterranean. And people have been scrabbling for replacement ever since. And Libyan oil is coming back online now. It's gradually those exports are increasing. But there is some of the light sweet grades that have been used as replacement. Those values have really jumped in grades such as Saharan blend or Azeri light crude. And now, of course, Syria is also having trouble, not an enormous producer of crude oil, but at least sentimentally, it's a key driver for some demand in the Mediterranean.
And of course, there's another geopolitical fear in the market right now, revolving around Iran and its confrontation with the West over its nuclear program.
Absolutely. Iran is one of those great enigmas, and any bellicose talk about Iran tends to make the flat price jump. The traders will buy into that very quickly. And the main reason is, while it is a significant producer of oil, it's in the top five in the world, I would say, and it's certainly OPEC's number two producer of crude oil, it's more a geographical thing, really. The Straits of Hormuz, of course, are that natural shipping choke point where so much oil gets out of the Gulf and out into the wider world. And any military action around there or any blockade would, of course, cause a huge jump in oil prices, is more than likely. We've seen recent predictions as high as $250 a barrel. I'm not sure if that's true, but certainly that choke point needs to be opened up. And of course, there are pipelines that can circumvent it to a degree, but it's still a problem for traders.
The high prices have clearly come at a time of great economic fragility in much of the world, particularly here in Europe, and are being, you know, great cause for concern for oil-consuming countries and importing countries. I think there's probably been an assumption that they're good news for people in the industry, but that's not necessarily the case. Is that right, Simon?
Very, very true. It's been a very dark year for a lot of the people involved in moving oil, in shipping. A couple of the big names of the shipping company having a terrible time. We saw just this last week, Genmar, one of the larger shipping companies, filing for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection in the US courts. Such is the bad state. And of course, this is a hell of a turnaround. Back in 2008, a mere 3 years ago, it couldn't be better for shippers. Big boom time. It was hundreds of thousands on daily earnings for moving a VLCC, or indeed any kind of boat, almost anywhere. That was part of the problem. The shipping owners thought that these good times would last. They reinvested in new boats, really refreshing the fleet. That's been a big change. 10 years ago, the fleet profile was very different. Now, less than 2% of the commercial boats in the world are older than 30 years. That's incredible. Nearly 50% of the entire commercial fleet is less than 2 years old. That tells you the amount of building that's been going on. And one of the big problems, that building is continuing. So we now see a lot more new boats coming to market at a time when, as you say, the global economy has suffered for most things, and there isn't the need, the requirement to move those bulk goods the way that there had been, and that's seen in the daily earnings.
And the VLCC market, those larger vessels, are the ones that are really hurting. The dirty freight market is a major pain point for the shipping industry. There's a little more hope for the clean tankers, the refined product tankers. But we've seen Frontline, the largest owner of very large crude carriers, in the last week or two, in cooperation with its shareholders, restructuring its financial plans and restructuring its company, in fact, to try and mitigate some of that damage that these prices are causing to the shippers.
Yeah, clearly very tough time for oil shippers. Refining margins also, when I look at what's happened this year, it's very obvious to me that even though you've had very high crude prices, the margin available to companies turning that crude into refined products has not been great.
No, again, particularly here in Europe, very, very difficult times for refiners around Europe. The entire refined market, from the light ends all the way to the heavy, has been suffering. The only glimmer of hope really has been middle distillates, light ends, particularly when you think about light ends, that's gasoline, the typical driving fuels. They can no longer rely on the US to pull in the seasonal way, which for 20 years was an assumed reality, the US would always drag for their driving season. That's not happening. We're not exporting as much gasoline because it isn't needed by the Americans. The Americans have less disposable income, suffering with their own economic issues, and are scaling down, are traveling less in smaller vehicles with smaller engines. Mm. The other big light ends, naphtha, which is a petrochemicals feedstock, has also been suffering. That's traditionally been supported by exports out of the region, and there's been too much in Europe. Even with refinery closures, there's been too much of that in Europe.
Yeah, you're touching on something quite interesting there. I mean, it's not just this year we've seen weak margins. Europe in particular, there seem to be some deeper structural problems in the refining industry. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely. There's certainly overcapacity among European refiners. And while that profile of product changes, the European refining community has to adapt.
That overcapacity, of course, is very interesting because there's overcapacity in the areas that we don't want it, and there's undercapacity in the areas where we need it.
Which would be what? To make more diesel?
To make more diesel, to make more jet fuel, to make more of the distillate-rich part of the barrel. A lot of Europe's refineries, of course, are aged. Come around from 60, 70 years ago, and they were more simple, less able to turn them into the products that we now need here in Europe. We've been reliant on Asia, really on Asia, to bring us from their more sophisticated, newer refineries the products that we need.
And as times have got tougher, we've seen companies such as Petroplus, for example, who is an independent refiner who concentrates on buying generally simpler refineries. They've had to shut plants here and there. There's talk of, well, of course, Teesside has already shut. Dunkirk has now shut down. And there's talk of German and Italian refineries also being mothballed or indeed shut totally. So the more complex refineries in Europe, such as Shell's Pernis plant or BP refining Rotterdam, they stand a better chance, of course, of making some kind of margin. But a lot of the products are now being brought in from another part of the world, particularly India. Saudi Arabia has growing refining plans as well, might be an even larger exporter of refined product into Europe. And that's, one wonders how long that will go on, because of course these economies in Asia have their own needs, and so as their middle class grows, as demand grows internally, we might not see quite so much export in the future, and Europe has to worry where that product is going to come from.
And of course that is an interesting dilemma, because Europe still requires a product and will price to do so. And it may seem straightforward to say, well, we should build new refineries, we should invest, but the cost of that is startlingly difficult here. Wood Mackenzie, a large analyst, says that merely on emissions alone, the emission trading scheme puts Europe at a 13% disadvantage to a refiner based somewhere east of Suez, India, South Korea. That's a startling starting point. Overall, it's estimated it's 20% more expensive to refine in Western Europe, if you like, even Eastern Europe, frankly, than it is east of Suez. That's a real disadvantage. And with freight, as we've talked about, not just depressed, but likely to continue depressed from a cost perspective, it's a strange reality that it is more economic to bring oil to Europe from South Korea than it is to build a refinery in Ireland or anywhere else within European waters.
Mm. I mean, to what extent do you think what we're seeing this year in this shift of focus to some extent, particularly in the refining sector, from Europe to Asia, is this sort of significant? Is this part of an underlying trend that we're going to continue?
Well, it's certainly the trend that we're seeing at the moment. We've seen investment in European refineries from India and China, for example. We have British refineries, two in particular I can think of, have been invested in by PetroChina and India's SR oil as well. And with so many of European refineries up for sale, it's going to be interesting to see who can make that work. And of course, these cash-rich countries are the kind of investors that might suit them quite well. Longer term, we tend to see much increased buying, I would say, from on crude oil from China, by China and also by India. For example, West African crude oil is seeing huge premiums to Dated Brent, that benchmark, as a result of India's and China's appetite for this crude. And while they can export the product, it makes sense for them to sell it out.
And this is where all the incremental demand is happening right now.
Well, a lot of it. I wouldn't say all of it, but certainly quite a lot of it. And there's a huge base load of support from China and India within, certainly, as I say, West African prices, but other grades as well. I mean, Russian Urals is heading over there more and more regularly and will continue to do so. With Russia opening up the Espo pipeline in the last couple of years out of eastern Russia, then Russia is managing to supply the local Asian market with a lot more ease, which is also another problem for the shippers, actually.
But lest we forget, of course, and we talk about the growth of Asia and the growth of the Asian markets, entirely fair, but the Americas shouldn't be discounted, has been the world's largest consumer of oil and is set to continue in that way, irrespective of whether that's slower rate of increase than anywhere else, than Asia and China and India in particular, but it is still a hugely dominant force on oil markets and will continue for at least 20 years. Who really knows how long it will be, but for a long time to come, the Americas will have an important hand. They're changing, of course, what's going on in America, the way their economy is structured, everything really about their world is changing, but they are hugely significant. And the Americas in general, Brazil is emerging as one of the largest new exporters of oil. That's something that wasn't really expected and anticipated, and that can't be underestimated in its impact. The US itself is looking to be one of the largest, or it believes it could be, one of the largest producers of oil or gas and oil combined by 2020. That's a significant change as well.
Right, well, I'd like to thank you both very much for coming in today to sort of share your insights on the market. I think we could go on for a lot longer, but that's all we've got time for today. So thanks very much. That's about it for this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. And this is our last edition for 2011. So have a good holiday, and we'll be back in January.